We're going to do something unusual here tonight. We're going to start on time.
I was going to make that joke.
I'm Dr. Woolley. I'm the provost on this campus, and I'm very pleased to welcome you here today. I want to give a special shout out to students from Lehigh University. If they made it here, did you make it here? They're right here. Great. Thanks for coming. And to the members of the United Nations Association. There are a handful of you here? All right. We're so glad you're here. I struggle to make a direct connection between the university, the historic part of the university, and the United Nations, because I'm welcoming you to Fairleigh Dickinson University here at our home in the historic Vanderbilt mansion. Now, this is a stretch, but now in 1919, let me go forward. The United Nations had a predecessor called the League of Nations. Many people view the League of Nations as a failure. But many other people say the League of Nations was really a predecessor to the United Nations. It was the prototype. So we're going to roll with that view. And then point out in 1919, President Wilson, Marshal Foch of France, the general of the French armies, Neville Chamberlain and Winston Churchill of Britain, and the American General Pershing, and many other people met in a place called Lenox, Massachusetts, where there's also a fabulous mansion called Elm Court. Elm Court was built and owned by Emily Thorne Vanderbilt. Emily had a younger sister by 2 years named Florence. Florence is with us tonight. She's right there, sitting over our guest and Dr. Scorza. And of course, Florence built this estate. So, I say we're first cousins once removed from the United Nations. Give me credit for trying, right? Okay. And now I'm going to let Dr. Murphy introduce the program from the Office of Global Learning. Welcome.
I would like to say that I was really enjoying the history lesson. I'm sorry it ended so quickly. Thank you, Peter. It is such a pleasure for us to see all of you here tonight and to have our special guests here from the United Nations. I'm going to tell you a little bit of the story about how this began. Fairleigh Dickinson University is a member of the NGO, non-governmental organization, DPI, Department of Public Information, Executive Committee at the United Nations. That is a body of non-governmental organizations that represent the NGOs throughout the world that are affiliated with DPI. Well, on that committee, I've had the privilege of working closely with Mrs. Maria Luisa Chavez, who is the chief of the NGO section of the Department of Public Information. And she and I have been talking for at least 5 to 6 months about this happening. And I have bugged her and bugged her, and she has smiled and said, it's going to happen. And of course, I just kept dreaming and hoping and praying, and she kept working and working and working to make it happen. So tonight is really thanks to her and thanks to the generosity of the Undersecretary General for spending this time with us this evening. I would also like to introduce to you Dr. Mary Norton, who is here representing the officers and the executive committee that I just spoke to you about. Dr. Norton is from Felician College. She is very well known in the UN network, and I do hope that after the event is over, that you'll take the opportunity to meet her and to network, because she knows a lot. Trust me. But thank you so much. This is going to be a very exciting evening for us. I know you did not come to hear me talk, so I'm just going to very quickly say, please be sure that your cell phones are off. We don't want to disturb the evening. So I see everyone bending over and turning off their cell phones very quietly. That is appreciated. And now I'm going to turn over the evening to Dr. Scorza.
Thank you very much, Dr. Murphy. I am Jason Scorza, Vice Provost for International Education here at Fairleigh Dickinson University. I am so pleased to see so many of you turn out tonight for our speaker and guest, but I'm not surprised. Our guest, Peter Launsky-Tieffenthal, has had a distinguished career preceding his arrival to the United Nations just 6 months ago.
A little bit more.
And he still has most of his hair. This is a very rare among senior officials.
Getting grayer by the minute.
at the United Nations. The format of tonight's program will include some opening remarks from our guest, followed by a conversation. My notes say inquisition, but that can't be right. Conversation between the two of us, and then we will open the program to questions from the floor with about 20 minutes reserved for that purpose. If you need to move around the room or exit and enter, please understand that the program is being videotaped. The microphones are very sensitive. We would ask that you use all caution and subtlety in your movements. So, if I may, sir, please.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Dr. Scorza, Provost Woolley, and Ms. Murphy, and mainly to all of you for having invited me and us, Maria Luisa and myself, to be with you tonight. I thought we were even closer related than sort of remote by one cousin. I was told by my colleagues that you were our first daughter, in a way, when it comes to the UN Academic Impact Program. And from that point of view, we feel as close as you do vis-a-vis us. It's a great privilege, and it goes without saying, a great honor for me to be with you here tonight. And as we were driving through the campus, I understand why you would like to and why you enjoy being here. And we were full of envy as we drove through the beautiful trees and lawns and the buildings and the inspiring atmosphere. So we share your affection for the university. This is my first time here, and it's great to see that the relationship that the two institutions, the United Nations and Fairleigh Dickinson, built goes back, I understand, to your late president, Dr. Michael Adams, who gave the initiative the shape and the substance that eventually, until today, led to a cooperation with more than 850 academic institutions worldwide and is growing rapidly. Secretary General Ban Ki-moon remarked not that long ago, the academic impact was in many ways and in many senses the so-called Adams impact, and it's failed till today, and that's why we are particularly happy to be back here at Fairleigh Dickinson. It is for us to recognize the importance and the benefits of that very close relationship from the point of view of the United Nations and the non-governmental organizations that are associated with us. And I know that many or some representatives of those NGOs with whom we have a very close relationship and weekly briefings are with us and very well looked after by my colleague Maria Luisa Chavez for many, many years. You've not come really to hear me talk a lot. We thought the best would be as a format to have a conversation and mainly to provide you an opportunity to ask questions or make comments, but we are always interested as to how you see the United Nations, what you identify, what efforts and what developments around the world you would be identifying with the United Nations. As was mentioned early on, I myself only joined a little more than 8 months ago. I served in the Austrian Foreign Service for nearly 30 years. I had the privilege of serving twice in the United States, in Washington, D.C. and in Los Angeles. I served on the Indian subcontinent for 8 years at two different times, and in the Middle East before joining the United Nations. Having come or coming from a city like Vienna, which is one of the three hubs of the UN, or main hubs, next to New York and Geneva, I very early on had exposure to the work of the United Nations, and I remember my father in and during the years of the Cold War, so before 1989, speaking of the importance of the presence of the United Nations in Austria being more important than the presence of army and soldiers from around the world to protect that region. Just to give you an idea as to how the sheer presence of the United Nations would have been considered important at that time. Now heading up the Department of Public Information and trying to get a feel as to what the United Nations does, I must say in that short period of time, I really came to appreciate the United Nations even more. As we are sitting here, our colleagues in the field around the world are helping millions of refugees. One and probably the most prominent example these days are the refugees in the neighboring countries of Syria, more than a million in the four neighboring countries of Syria, and 2.5 million displaced people within Syria that our colleagues are trying to support with shelter, with tents, with food, with medical supply, under very difficult circumstances, both in government-controlled areas, in areas that are controlled by the opposition, and in some cases, in areas that are being held by partly government and partly opposition. The United Nations sees to it that more than half the children worldwide would undergo vaccination programs, and by doing so, save the lives of more than 2.5 million kids every single year. As you know, one of the main goals of the United Nations and of Secretary General Ban Ki-moon are the so-called Millennium Development Goals, and one of its main goals from within that group is to fight and end poverty and hunger, and also fight against the violence against women and children. UN staffers are working on the front lines of many of the conflicts in areas where others have either given up or simply don't want to be anymore, frequently under very dangerous conditions, to make that difference in the lives of people. And when I joined the UN, and since that very first day, I've always tried to ask my colleagues in whatever we do, to ask ourselves, is what we are discussing here and the decisions that we are taking, are they relevant to making an impact and bring about an improvement in people's lives out there? It's not just a club to discuss issues, but it's important that whatever is being decided in New York has an impact on the lives of people around the world, and particularly people in need. This is a big challenge, as you imagine. As a global organization, it is important to tell that story and to try to tell that story in as many languages as possible. You may know that we try to tell the story in at least 6 languages, in most cases 8, other than English, French, and Spanish, Arabic, Chinese, and Russian. We try to tell the story now also in Portuguese, in Swahili, and through our network of UN information centers around the world, in as many additional languages as possible. As many other institutions around the globe, we are being tasked to do more with less increasingly. Only this morning I was invited to defend the budget of the Department of Public Information, and as you imagine, got a lot of questions as to how we intend to go about communicating the United Nations in the year to come with less stuff, with less money, but hopefully with a certain sense of creativity to overcome these cuts. One of the main tasks I see is how can we translate the legislative processes that happen in New York and to relate them to the effect they have on the ground in the member states. As you know, the Security Council, the General Assembly, many committees in New York negotiate, discuss, and today in that sense was a very successful day. The General Assembly adopted a resolution on the issue of arms trade, and it was considered one of the most important breakthroughs in that field of disarmament. How do these treaties, these resolutions, then translate in the field, and what impact do they have on people on the ground? I'm excited by all those challenges. They pose a lot of opportunities. I consider them more opportunities rather than obstacles. And Garrett Evans, the former Australian Prime Minister, only recently remarked, he's now the head of the so-called International Crisis Group. He said, the United Nations provides fabulous value for what the world spends on it. And we looked up before coming here what the budget of the United Nations, if you relate it to other institutions, it's about half the annual budget of the city of New York. It's under a third of what the United States military spends every year in Afghanistan. And it is far less than the annual bonuses provided by Wall Street to its main bankers. So we feel it's money well spent, and it's, I get up to us to explain why we think that money is well spent. Of course, the value of the United Nations lies in much more than crude financial facts and figures. This organization was born in the ashes post-World War II, and it should also be measured in conflicts that it prevented, something that is very often forgotten, in the human rights that were being upheld in crisis areas, and not the least in treaties signed that benefited people. And Garrett Evans, one more time, he said, if the UN ceased to exist, we would have to reinvent it. And on that note, thank you so much again, and I'm ready for our conversation.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Let's begin with some of the fundamentals.
Yeah.
We've mentioned already this thing called the Department of Public Information, the United Nations Department of Public Information. But I'm willing to gamble that many of us in the room don't really know what that means, don't know what the organization is, don't know the extent of its operations and activities. So could you start us off by telling us a little bit about this department that you administer?
Happy to do that. We are 750 colleagues, both at the United Nations headquarters in New York and at 63 UN information offices around the world. As indicated earlier on, one of the main responsibilities is to tell the stories that our colleagues in the field and at headquarters write on a day-to-day basis in as many languages as possible to as many audiences as possible. We have quite a lot of audiences. We have first and foremost 193 member states who are kind of members of the board, who also hold the power of the purse since the budget is being provided by them. So they have a shot at us, and by their mandates, they basically tell us what they would like us to do. We have increasingly a number of partners. We touched upon the Academic Impact Program, we touched upon the NGOs, and obviously we try to interact with media. And currently there are a couple of hundred UN-based correspondents who cover the work of the United Nations headquarters in New York. And we are trying to disseminate information both via new media as well as traditional media. And maybe this is a good example to show you the kind of challenges we face. There are many countries who tell us, well, you should completely focus on social media these days. That's a great way of saving money, and it's a very quick way of turning out information. At the same time, you have maybe twice as many countries who approach us at the very same time and tell us, well, we understand and we appreciate the value of the new media, but our population can only be reached by traditional media. So please continue disseminating information via UN radio, via television, and via printed materials, and not just e-books. Now, thank God to latest technology, it's possible to reduce costs for print-on-demand publications, so we do not have to print in the thousands or tens of thousands, but we can print if someone really wants a publication to be printed, and we can have it printed in a particular member state and get it out there to the audience as quickly as possible. The role of the information centers is really to help us on the ground in the same way to connect with academic institutions, with the public at large, with NGOs, with the media to disseminate the very same information. Just to give you an idea, the UN, the main UN Twitter account has currently more than 1.3 million followers. The Weibo Twitter account has a Weibo account in China has roughly 3.5 million followers, and by followers we mean individuals or institutions with whom we interact on a regular basis. So these are not just one-time guests or visitors on our accounts. So this is sort of in a nutshell.
Thank you.
What the department is all about.
You raised a very interesting challenge, the idea of having 193 bosses to whom one is accountable. I feel that way sometimes, but we're not here to talk about my problems. When you deal with sensitive issues, there must be some member state that doesn't like how you've covered the issue or how you've disseminated information. How does that dynamic work? How do you work with member states on issues that are of the highest sensitivity?
No, I think it's like in a personal relationship. In those cases where it's possible to build a relationship and to build trust with each other, it always helps to sort out differences better. And the same is true for our relationship with member states. We try to organize a lot of projects jointly with member states. I'll give you an example, a very recent example. We commemorated the transatlantic slave trade, and more than 75 countries were historically touched by the transatlantic slave trade on all sides of the seas. And we jointly with them and the committee that they created prepared a week-long program on the commemoration of the transatlantic slave trade. And as a result of this working together, we were able to establish a closer relationship with these member countries and obviously try to do that over a longer period of time. And then once a sensitive issue comes up, hopefully that will help us to be able to talk about it and to find a solution. And in most cases, that works. But as I indicated early on, the view of one member state may not be necessarily shared by other member states. So it's not just the relationship between us and the member state, but to also act as a go-between between member states and make sure that some kind of common ground can be found.
Interesting. Beyond the member states themselves, you're also responsible for representing the Secretary General and presumably some of the principal decision-making arms of the United Nations. How are those relationships operated or executed? The General Assembly makes a decision. What do you do? What does your staff do?
To come back to the first part of the question, yes, it is true. Part of our office is the so-called office of the spokesman or the spokesperson for the Secretary General. They are part of the Department of Public Information, and he presides over the daily news briefings and accompanies the Secretary General as we are sitting here right now on a trip to Europe, I think from Andorra to Luxembourg as we speak, and he does the day-to-day briefings for the media, not just here in New York, but around the world. The Department for Public Information, and in another aspect, is trying to provide the basis for longer-term strategies. I'll give you an example. A year ago, we had the conference in Rio the Rio Plus 20 conference, and the Department for Public Information creates everything from the logo to the website to the stationery to the posters to the messaging that goes hand in hand with such a conference. And that messaging is then being shared, and that comes back to the second part of your question, is then being shared with the principals, not just of the Secretariat in New York, but with the heads of all the agencies. And many of you would know maybe institutions like UNICEF or UNESCO or the International Atomic Energy Agency worldwide. Now, I think it's an illusion to believe that it is possible to really centrally guide this kind of aircraft carrier of the United Nations. And I think the developments in terms of new media make a spokesperson in a way of each and every one of you and of us, and therefore also of all our colleagues. And so we thought the better way to do it is to empower colleagues, to provide them with the necessary information, and then to encourage them to, as they speak up about the work of the UN, to do so via new media, but also via traditional media in their day-to-day interaction. Mm. So DPI really does both the day-to-day news as well as the strategic communication, if you will.
I see. And you obviously liaise with a wide variety of different kinds of organizations and entities outside of the UN system itself. We've mentioned the Academic Impact Program, which I suspect not everyone here knows in any particular detail, but it's an effort to engage universities around the world in the work of the United Nations. You work, of course, also with non-governmental organizations. How do you view those organizations? Are they primarily outlets to convey further information into their respective communities and networks? Or are there things that as a Department of Public Information, you want from them?
I think the precious part of this relationship is the fact that NGOs, academic institutions, other partners are so much more closer to the people of this world than kind of a bureaucratic administration like the United Nations, particularly when it comes to the Secretariat in New York. And therefore, the partnership is both. We try to learn, to listen. We are interested in the feedback that these institutions provide us, coming from their interaction with their members, with their students, with their participants. And at the same time, we are also happy if those institutions are willing to help us to tell the story of the United Nations mm-hmm. to their members, to their students, to their participants. So it's in a way it goes both ways. Mm. And Maria Luisa, my colleague who is with us tonight, she arranged for many years these so-called weekly briefings for NGOs, which focus on sharing thematic priorities of the United Nations with our NGO partners, not just to explain it to them, but in the hope that they would then go out and carry on this message to their members.
Fairleigh Dickinson University is, many of you will know, a registered NGO with the Department of Public Information and proud to be so. And we benefit in large part because of our proximity to the United Nations. We can put groups of students in a shuttle or on a bus, take them to the briefings. We've brought students to the UNDPI NGO conferences, which have been held in such wonderful places as Paris and Mexico City. And I have a few places on my list that I'll share with you later that we'd like to go to in the future. But for institutions that are not geographically close to the UN, as Fairleigh Dickinson University is, as Lehigh University is to a somewhat a lesser degree. What can you offer? What can you offer them to engage them in the sort of work that we engage in?
Yeah. Well, first of all, you mentioned that some of these NGO conferences, for example, were being held outside UN headquarters in New York with exactly that purpose, yeah. to kind of go where the people are and go where our partners are and go where we hope to find new partners. And that is not only true in the case of our partnerships with NGOs, but that is also true, for example, in the case of programs with universities, and it's also true for programs with journalists from different regions of the world. So, for example, we're in the process of planning a seminar with journalists from the Middle East in Istanbul late in June. So to be close to the region and to overcome the geographic distance. Now, thanks God, having said so, new media offers an opportunity via webcast to communicate basically with most parts of the world from headquarters. And in fact, one of the priorities of Department of Public Information was to create the committee meetings, the open meetings, even more transparent, mm-hmm. by webcasting them, or offering a webcast to interested followers of the work of the United Nations. And we see that being received very well.
Excellent. We've seen a variety of strategies adopted by the Department of Public Information over the years. There's clearly what you would call a public relations or PR role. There's also an educational role, which you take quite seriously. But we've been noticing a great number of, for lack of a better word, celebrities hanging around the UN and particularly around the Department of Public Information. And this is not merely of interest to those of us who would like to meet Angelina Jolie, and we'll talk about that later. But for those of us, and we have many students from our communication department here tonight who are interested in the nuts and bolts of how you disseminate a message, I think they'd be interested in learning about the genesis of that initiative, mm-hmm. What you hope to gain from it, and what we might expect to see in the future.
Yeah. Well, I would say there are two main strands. One, and that's sort of the more recent one, is a growing cooperation with the creative community worldwide. What does that mean? We work closely with Hollywood, with Bollywood, as of late with Nollywood, that's sort of the Nigerian African film industry. And today I got a note that there are 38 film projects in the making worldwide with UN product placement. And these might be feature films, these might be documentaries, television series. I mean, I will give you an example. The latest episode of The Amazing Race was shot at UN headquarters and was watched by more than 12 million people. And it featured the flags of the member states, the languages spoken at the United Nations, and some other basic facts and figures. When it comes to feature films or documentaries, the main purpose of product placement, UN product placement, would be to look at, for example, issues related to gender, to domestic violence, to poverty alleviation, to human rights related issues. And we find a great interest, beginning with the script writers, then via the producers to then the actors and actresses. Mm-hmm. So that is one strand which is growing and will be going soon to Los Angeles. We were able to win UCLA Berkeley Institute as one of our partners to help us to identify film projects very early on that may have a connection to the priorities of the United Nations. The second strand, and that's the one that you mainly refer to, is a long-standing cooperation with outstanding personalities from the world of film, culture, sports. We realized, as I'm sure many other institutions as well, you just can't do anything alone these days. You need a team, you need partners, and you need visibility through personalities of international renown. And one of the first events I had the privilege at the United Nations to actively participate in was the International Day of Peace, or the UN Day of Peace. And we were joined on that day by individuals like Forrest Whitaker, or Jane Goodall, Elie Wiesel, who all lent their respective personal experience to a cause. In the case of Forrest Whitaker, it's the issue of children soldiers, child soldiers, for example. What can we do to protect children from being drafted into an army at age 12 or 14 around the world? In the case of Elie Wiesel, clearly it's the issue of xenophobia, of anti-Semitism, of human rights. We work closely with Angelina Jolie, as you mentioned, when it comes to demining programs, for example. Now, when I say we, this is the entire UN family, and it is in some cases UNICEF who approaches these individuals and asks them whether they would be interested to lend their name and their a number of their public appearances to a particular cause. It is UNESCO when it comes to the protection of cultural heritage around the world, that they would call upon artists, for example, to help them to spread the message. And so on. And it is a very effective way of promoting UN work to a broader audience through these well-known
voices. I'm going to press you on this. Because
please.
If you have a celebrity spokesperson for Poland Spring Water, you can have a sense of the effectiveness based on how many units of product you move in. How in the Department of Public Information do you evaluate the effectiveness of different campaigns and techniques? I mean, how do you know that Brad Pitt is moving, you know, landmines? Not literally, but.
I agree with you. It's one of the big challenges. And so we try to spend quite a lot of money on analytical tools. And that is not just with regard to celebrities. But, for example, the UN creates television footage, radio footage, which it provides to networks around the world who are not or who do not have a correspondent, in this case in New York, and to make sure that they can broadcast a particular program in their country. And there, too, it is not that easy to prove whether that footage has actually then been screened on a television somewhere in Africa, in Latin America, or in Asia. And through kind of more modern technology, we are increasingly able to do so. When it comes to the celebrities, from our point of view, so far the best indicator came from social media. Mm-hmm. Clearly, the traffic on social media increases rapidly. I think Maria-Luisa helped me quickly. We had the International Day of Peace last year, and we had a very famous singer who came to the General Assembly. Was before I joined the UN, and it was clicked more than 1 billion times within a very, very short period of time. Now, that so-called click is also still free to interpretation, but obviously quite a lot of people around the globe associated themselves and somehow showed an interest in the message that came from that particular artist. Mm-hmm. And I think in that sense, social media help us to measure the output.
Oh, by the way, if not Angelina Jolie, if you can't get us Angelina, Charlize Theron would be fine. That would
be we'll
be
choice. With her in about 10 days.
Okay, so we'll talk about that as well. as I said, many of our students are interested in careers in public relations, communication, media, journalism. You mentioned, I was quite impressed by the number, 750 staff within the department. What fields do they tend to come from? What kinds of preparation do you look for in officers in your department?
To be quite honest, I had the opportunity to, before coming to New York, to sit on a panel that selected so-called junior professionals for one job here in New York and one at the UN in Vienna. And I must say, when I read their CVs, they should have interviewed me and not I should have interviewed them. I was struck by what a 25-year-old or young lady or a gentleman would have already done, both in terms of academic achievements as well as in terms of practical experience, if I kind of would look back at when I was 25. So it's become, on one hand, very, very difficult because there are lots of very qualified people out there. And for example, one job that we just talked on the car journey about had 240 candidates, and candidates who most of them would be qualified on paper for the job. So what comes to it, and I'm sure that's quite similar to an institution like the university here, you also look at the personality and to what extent this particular personality would fit into the institution as a whole, but more specifically into the kind of job opening that you're trying to fill. I'm sure there are professionals and lots of professionals out there who would be able to tell you much more about it, but from the interviews that I took, both actively and passively, I felt that that was a very strong element when it comes to the United Nations, because the commitment to the objectives of the institution, at the same time certain administrative skills to see to it that those objectives can be, if not fulfilled or reached, but at least you can work towards their realization. So you need a little bit of idealism and you need quite a lot of realism. And hopefully the interviews that we are arranging for kind of focus, apart from obviously academic and professional expertise, on those two aspects.
Interesting. I'd like to change gears significantly.
Quicker or slower?
I'm not sure. Let's see how it goes. You know, in any public relations activity, not all the news is going to be good. But then, you know, and there are ways of dealing with that. I'm interested in hearing about how you deal with ambiguity, because so much of the work of the UN is ambiguous in terms of its actual results, in terms of its actual impact. So I'm gonna pose to you the question of the Millennium Development Goals. Mm-hmm. It seems to me there's a number of different ways to present the story of the MDGs. Mm-hmm. You can present them as a triumph, a great success story, a transformative program. It could also be looked at as a failure, because in fact, by 2015, the goals will not have been met. How do you tell that story? How do you want that story to be told? How do you need that story to be told?
I would say the MDGs, or the so-called Millennium Development Goals, and we touched upon some of them: poverty alleviation, access to education, protection of women and children when it comes to violence. The good thing about the MDGs is that there is general agreement that something needs to be done with regard to those goals. I mean, we have to do something to achieve those goals, which is already quite something, because in many cases, member states cannot agree on pursuing a particular objective, and a lot of time and energy gets, quote unquote, wasted in coming to a consensus on where to go. So when it comes to the MDGs, there is general agreement. The problem is, and I think that is a communications challenge, is to break down these goals into something that becomes relevant and tangible to each and every one of us. Poverty alleviation sounds great, but unless and until you can show it on the basis of a particular family, a man, a woman, a child in a particular country, it will not become emotionally relevant. And I see it as one of our main responsibility to explain the MDGs, but the entire work of the UN in such a way that what and how we present the work of the UN, that becomes relevant and understandable to the public at large. Mm-hmm. And I mean, when we open a newspaper, when we watch television, the most compelling stories are the ones that are linked to a particular individual. Then we start identifying ourselves with that story and with the cause in a different way than if we do that with a more abstract term, as would be poverty, as important as it may be. Mm-hmm. And in that sense, that doesn't require so much to deal with ambiguity. Ambiguity is maybe more with regard to the assessment of progress. Is that what you meant?
Right. The story can be looked at easily two different ways, and probably more than two different ways. It can be looked at, you know, as a program, an initiative that transformed the lives, no exaggeration, of millions upon millions upon millions of the most needy and deserving people in the world. It could also be spun by critics of the UN as a failure. You know, of the 8 goals, how many will be met by the deadline? Probably none, maybe a couple. You don't want people to be disillusioned. Mm-hmm. You want people to carry on. Mm-hmm. But you also don't want to declare victory when there is no victory.
You will see the Secretary General, in fact, day after tomorrow in Madrid, will call for a renewed effort to meet those very MDGs. There are 1,000 days remaining until the end of 2015. Now, I think what we can say, honestly, is that there has been progress on all these goals, which may not have happened if that initiative may not have been started at all. Mm-hmm. You are absolutely right, we may not get to the 100% mark, but I get that if we are fair, we have to compare it to where we would be if it didn't happen. So from that point of view, from a communications point of view, I imagine we would say, well, listen, this is the progress that we've achieved. So and so many more children now have access to education. So and so many more children have access to vaccination, and so on. And it's true, it's not just material indicators. There are other ways of measuring it as well. It is a challenge, but I think on the MDGs, people recognize that there has been progress. Mm. They also recognize that more needs to be done, and that at a time of constraints on financial and other resources, it is even more important to stress those MDGs, and that's why the Secretary General is.
So you provide the broader context of the world economy. Is that part? Does that become part of the story?
Well, it becomes important when we talk to member states, when we tell them, listen, we understand your financial constraints, but we believe that your resources should also and continue to be dedicated to achieving or moving closer to these so-called Millennium Development Goals.
One UN partner that we have not touched upon, one external UN partner that we've not touched upon yet, is the private sector, the corporate world. There's a very significant initiative within the UN called the Global Compact, which is an effort to enlist companies, particularly larger companies, on behalf of the mission of the UN. Is that a program that you work with as part of the Department of Public Information?
There's one specific part of the United Nations that oversees this program, but in the way we present this cooperation with the private sector, it becomes also part of the Department for Public Information. In fact, today I had a conversation with a colleague who was telling me about the interest of the energy sector in many of the crisis spots where the United Nations is actively involved. Because the way we look at it is we feel that we try to restore a certain stability in a country that makes the country ready for investment. We try to overcome war or civil war-like situations. We try to overcome and help to overcome natural disasters. We try to help further education. But in the end, the countries require investment. And power being one issue that obviously is important to the population of these countries. These investments will only come if the UN is successful, together with many other partners, obviously, to kind of create this stable environment that would attract investment.
Last, the last question for me, at any rate, before we unleash the wolves. The UN has a reputation. Well, first of all, these are our friends. You look out here. These are people who care about the United Nations and the work that the UN does. Mm-hmm. Not all Americans feel that way. And the United States, for better or worse, is one of the, if not the, leading supporter financially of the United Nations. We have not always paid our bills on time. And I'm sorry. We have seen the most absurd grandstanding occur in such houses as the House of Representatives. How, as a public relations and an outreach entity, do you confront a challenge like that? People who are fed misinformation, not just, you know, deceptive information, but outright paranoid information. Most recently, we heard that the UN is going to come for our guns. Do you just walk away from that? Do you give up? Or are there strategies that can be used to address outright hostility to the UN in critical demographics?
Well, first of all, you may have seen recently there was a Pew Institute poll on how the American public views the work of the United Nations, and if I remember correctly, about two-thirds of the Americans recognized that the UN is playing a role, and it was in the interest of the United States, or it is in the interest of the United States, to see a successful United Nations and to have them hosted in New York. So I think from that point of view, the public at large has an overwhelmingly positive view. But it's up to us to go out there and to explain why it benefits the United States. Why, for example, a peacekeeping operation in Mali that is done by UN soldiers eventually benefits the stability in Africa. It does not require US soldiers to go there. And by creating a stable environment in a part of Africa also benefits US interests, because it might be connected to the fight against terrorism, for example. Now, that simply needs to be explained. And since I lived 4 years in Washington, I learned this term of inside the beltway. And I feel it's a little bit similar in New York very often, inside sort of Manhattan, because we focus so much on what the legislative bodies, the Security Council, does or doesn't do or achieve or doesn't achieve, that we forget about what our colleagues are doing on a day-to-day basis in the field. I gave you a couple of numbers and figures early on, but for example, there are 35 demining programs in 35 different countries run by the UN as we speak. And what they do is they enable kids to walk out of their homes and play in the fields without the fear of losing a limb. So it's a very specific contribution. And I think if we are able to tell that story, the American public, but also the decision makers would understand. And I had the privilege of accompanying the Secretary General recently on a visit to New York after the new, after the elections, both Senate, House of meaning House of Representatives, and administration. And I must say, in the interaction between the Secretary General, the members of Congress, the senators, Secretary of State Kerry, our positions, UN and US, were kind of absolutely in sync. So nothing was to be felt of criticism. In fact, on the contrary, it's a way of sharing roles. There are areas where the UN can be more effective, and there are clearly areas where the United States can be more effective. And I think to bring those two together make for a very strong couple.
Very good. Ladies and gentlemen, do we have the microphones for the Q&A? All right. What I'll ask you to do is raise your hand to be recognized, step one. Step B, introduce yourself. And step three, ask your question more succinctly than I've been asking my questions. Thanks. Please, in the second row.
Good evening, everyone, and good evening to you, Under Secretary General Tieffenthal and Vice Provost Scorza. I'm a young global leader with the World Economic Forum, and I am a Fletcher graduate, Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy. I'm very happy to be here tonight, and I actually have two questions for you. I'll try to be as brief as possible. One was, at the beginning of this evening, it was mentioned that the League of Nations was the predecessor of the UN. The League of Nations was the dream of Woodrow Wilson, and he lost his health, and he died promoting the League of Nations, his dream. And my question is, the League of Nations was born when the world was multipolar. The UN was born and acted, operated when the world was and still is unipolar. But there are discussions, and the reality of today is that the world will soon be bipolar. And so how would the UN continue its work when China's military rise, especially in the South China Sea, is going to become not only a reality but a threat to US's military power, superpower? That's the first question. And the second question is, I know that the UN is involved in human rights. And one issue that came to my mind is the issue of child marriage, especially in Nepal. I think it's most prevalent there. And I know that a lot of initiatives have been taken in the past years, but the reality is 10 million girls every year under the age of 12 are being married off because of family poverty, extreme poverty. How will the UN use its partnerships with including celebrities like Angelina Jolie and maybe institutions like the Clinton Global Initiative to help eradicate that situation? Thank you so much.
Thank you. Would you like me to answer straight away?
I would.
Yeah. Now, with regard to multipolar, unipolar, bipolar, I think since we spend quite some time talking about the Millennium Development Goals, clearly those goals will remain irrespective of the fact whether the world is going this way or that way. Unfortunately, poverty alleviation will remain a challenge. Education will remain a challenge. And so in that sense, nothing much is going to change, at least from right now. Having said so, with regard to conflict prevention, I think that issue is going to become even more important. We'll have to work more towards preventing conflicts, both from a security point of view as well as from an economic point of view. And that's why somewhere in my remarks I mentioned the that we should not just look at where we were able to bring about an end to a conflict, but we should also look at areas where we may have been able to prevent it from breaking out in the first place. And the one of the priorities of the Secretary General is to increase both human as well as material resources and efforts on this, on the issue of preventive diplomacy. And I think we'll be seeing more of that, and it will be up to us to talk about it also more. And hopefully it will prove to be an instrument that will help us to prevent conflicts from breaking out in the first place. Now, with regard to child marriage, I couldn't agree more with you. It's horrible what one hears, one reads. I myself, as I mentioned, lived 8 years in India and spent a lot of time in Nepal, not the least on this particular issue in my previous capacity. A lot more needs to be done. We found that celebrity advocates are one way of doing it in terms of attracting international attention. Other ways are to hold member states responsible for what is happening within their borders. And there's a dialogue with Nepal on this particular issue. And hopefully that too will lead to legislation in the member country that would help us to come closer to solving this problem. You may have followed the conference that has ended at the UN only a couple of days ago that was dominated by women-related issues. And during that conference, the issue of child marriage was a very prominent one. It also showed that, difficult to believe, there are member states who could not agree on tackling this issue because they consider cultural and historic reasons at this stage still more important than preventing child marriage. So yes, it is a challenge, but both with the help of assisting member states to institute legislation in their own country, at the same time talking more publicly about this issue through the help of advocacy, hopefully will help us to come closer to tackling it. Thank you.
And you have sort of snuck up on an interesting dichotomy, which is the role of the UN in arbitrating relations among states and the role of the UN in dealing with internal affairs of states, whether they be civil war type situations or addressing legislative needs or some legislative aspirations. To what extent is the UN sort of sensitized to that dichotomy? To what extent is it part of its strategy to balance those two sets of demands?
I think it's inherent to the institution. And sometimes when we talk about the United Nations, we mean the member states, effectively. Because if it weren't for the member states, those resolutions, like the one we mentioned earlier on arms trade, would not have happened. It's more the moral authority of the Secretary General and the institution that can help to get member states to move into a particular direction. Mm-hmm. And I imagine, like we referred to early on, you look for partners, you look for like-minded partners to help you to press a particular issue. And like-minded partner in this case are mainly member states when it comes to the legislative process. But it also includes NGOs, it includes academic institutions, and not the least the media, to help us to raise awareness and through that awareness get something else.
Who has the next question? We will take the young lady in, I want to say, the fifth row with her hand up, and then we'll start on the right side of the room.
Hi, Hello, my name is Alexis Abdelnour. I'm a student from the Metropolitan Campus. Thank you for taking your time out to visit us and discuss all this with us. My question is, can the Department of Communications and Public Information measure if its publications are being accessed by illiterate populations, by populations who can't afford a radio or a computer, and to populations whose government censors the media and information relayed to their citizens? If so, which methods are used?
Well, to the first part of your question, when we talked about how can we access populations in countries where, for example, new media are not available, one effective tool seems to be to provide a smartphone or mobile phone or content via mobile phone. For example, many African countries now tell us this is the most effective way of communicating directly with their populations. And from the feedback that we get, that seems to be the case. Now, to the second part of the question, you're absolutely right. It's a big challenge to overcome barriers that prevent us from communicating into countries that may make it difficult to access them. And I mean, in the more recent past, there are two or three countries that would come to my mind where that is the case. One shouldn't forget, I think it's important to place any singular issue into a broader context. These member countries, as and how they work in the United Nations, they also have interests themselves. They may be in some totally different area, but there is, like in real life, a lot of give and take. So when they want something from another member state, that member state will say, well, we'd be happy to help you, but what about freedom of press in your country? What about access of information in your country? So I think that is also how the member states deal with each other in reality. It's a give and take. And in that sense, each and every member state has to weigh up what is more important. If I want to achieve my objectives or come closer to those, what am I willing to give away as a counter bargain? And when it comes to access for and to information, I'm sure that is something which is being played out at the level of member states. Now, the UN does it in direct contact with member states. We would raise issue of, for example, protection of journalists. UNESCO is very, very active around the globe to raise awareness for situations where journalists are being prevented from basically doing their job. And as I indicated early on, UN also provides and creates content. We do make radio, not just in New York and provide the content, but we do make radio in member states, mainly in those member states where there's a strong UN presence, be it through peacekeeping or otherwise. And there too, we are being faced with exactly those challenges that you mentioned. Some of the content may not please that member state, but we insist on that content being broadcast. And in many cases, we are successful because the services that we provide to that country in terms of stability, in terms of humanitarian assistance, in terms of reconstruction efforts after a natural disaster, in the end are also in the interest of that country and its governing elite. So I think the way to look at it is always how can I solve a problem, not just that problem, but I'll see it in a broader context.
Let's move to this side of the house. I see a hand in the first row and several hands in the fifth row. The fifth row is really on point tonight, on fire. But why don't we start down front in the first row, please?
Thank you. I'm Donna Rosa. I'm from the Northern New Jersey chapter of United Nations Association, UNA USA. I would like to ask, what in your communications career with the United Nations, what single incident or circumstance presented the largest challenge to you, and how did you handle it?
Well, it's a very short period that I can look back upon. Well, I will not mention the member state because it will get me into trouble, but I will...
You could use the initials, does it begin?
I won't be lured into that either. Quite recently, the UN-based correspondents have a program whereby they invite individuals from around the world for kind of an internal briefing. And these individuals are often members of an opposition, sometimes clandestine, sometimes in exile, of a particular regime or government in a particular member state. And we've upheld the tradition that these UN-based journalists, who have also physically with their offices on campus of the UN Secretariat in New York, that they can do that, even though we are aware and sometimes made aware by member states that they disapprove of the individuals who are being invited, because clearly they express views that are not being shared by the government of the day of that particular country. And recently we had such an incident. Such a development. And the challenge was, we were being made aware by that member state that the temporary venue these journalists are using for this meeting, because of the renovation works that are ongoing in the Secretariat building, is a venue that should only be given out to member states, to recognized NGOs, or to members of the UN family, but not necessarily to an institution like the UN correspondents. And they said, well, the UN is a member states driven institution. We, as member states, we pay you, we mandate you to do certain things, and we definitely don't pay and mandate you to do things that would be critical of the government of the day. Now, that's sort of one side of the story. The other side of the story is what I mentioned at the outset, to maintain and preserve and protect the freedom of expression and press freedom. And the UN being very keen on being a location where different views can be voiced, not necessarily only from one member state vis-a-vis another one, but in a way also within a member state. So we kind of had to weigh up what do we do to resolve this situation. Because clearly, if one had asked them to move out of the compound, we would have violated freedom of press, even though this meeting would have still gone ahead, but outside. And at the same time, the point that was taken by the member state was kind of well taken, because it was not the usual location where these type of briefings take place, because that space is under renovation. So they were being provided with temporary facilities that were dedicated to something else. So the way we eventually tried to deal with it was to provide or to ask the journalists to come up with some alternative space, which was their own office space. So in the end, it still took place on the campus of the UN headquarters in New York. But it was in a less controversial space that was not necessarily dedicated in the same way as the original one. In the end, both sides were unhappy, but both sides could live with it. And so in that sense, it's a small example that cost quite a lot of time. We took quite a lot of flak. But under the given options, we felt that was kind of the best deal we could reach.
Let's come starting this way. The gentleman on the aisle. Yeah, I don't know if you have that authority to make that decision, but I'll accept it.
Hello, it's very nice to meet you. Thank you very much for the opportunity to speak with you.
Thank you.
It was mentioned earlier that there was 1.3 million Twitter followers, and as a student currently studying both the social media impact as well as the impact of public relations, I am very interested to know which media platform, if it's not Twitter, do you find is most propitious for the UN to distribute information to the people? And speaking in terms of public relations, specifically crisis management, what is the best way to reach the people about the issue at hand?
Well, I will share something very honestly with you. We recently experienced, as maybe many of you here in New Jersey, the Hurricane Sandy. And Hurricane Sandy kind of showed us where all our limits were in terms of...
Never build by a river.
That is true. That was one absolutely. Never put cooling systems for computer servers in the deep basement. The servers were all safe, but the cooling systems were not. Don't put precious archives below the ground, and many more. But, I mean, just to highlight to you, a lot of crisis plans were being developed and are constantly being developed by the United Nations for all sorts of crises. But obviously the least one would have been something of this type in New York to UN headquarters. The reason why I'm raising this example is because it made communication with member states, communication with colleagues, communications with the media from within UN headquarters in New York nearly impossible. It was impossible to tell our colleagues that the UN was closed. It was impossible to tell member states that there were no meetings or that there was some kind of a meeting. It was impossible to communicate with media as we usually do it via all the sorts of platforms that you can imagine, whether it's via our website. There was an emergency website through which we had communicated, whose server was headquarters based and went down as much as all the others did. Only externally based servers were able to operate. But because those whom we tried to address had exactly the same problems, we couldn't reach them, and even those mails or tweets or whatever that may have gone out, SMS, short message systems with short messages, which in most cases would be kind of the simplest technology to reach out, they also didn't work because you sent it, but you weren't sure whether the other one got it because the networks were down. So I'm bringing this example that as much as we may look at all the ways and means to get our message out, even in, and particularly in a crisis situation, it just shows us that we are very, very limited. Now, in terms of the day-to-day operations, we really apply and go through each and every possible venue that you can imagine. As I mentioned, we create content for radio, for television. We try to update our websites, and there are several of them, which complicates the matter at the same time shows the variety of the services that are being provided. We try to do that in those many languages and as many languages as possible. Many colleagues of ours have their own Twitter account, so it's not just the UN account, but their personal accounts. Personalized accounts, and they try, and these Twitter accounts try to reinforce each other's messages by referring to each other and by sharing links that the other one would have shared in the first place. We have colleagues who write blogs, and I learned not that long ago that a blog today doesn't mean you have to write pages of stuff, but it's sometimes enough to have an image and a short text, and that's also called a blog. So many colleagues do that. And through Flickr, we try to provide photographs. When the Secretary General is on the trip, we try to go beyond just the handshake photographs with other dignitaries in the country that he visits. For example, recently, on this trip to Washington, we made it a point to go with the Secretary General to Lincoln Memorial. That was shortly before we celebrated transatlantic slave trade and shortly before the Oscars in Los Angeles and Lincoln being a movie that was being nominated. So kind of create links between our work and the work of other institutions. I hope that answers a little bit your question. Thank you.
You've given up your opportunity to speak, so let's move to the young lady right there.
Good evening, and thank you for the opportunity. My name is Shilpa. I'm studying Master's in Diplomatic Management and International Affairs at the Metropolitan Campus. Mm-hmm. As we have seen, the role of UN and the NGOs is bilateral. And as you have mentioned before, you've worked in the Indian subcontinent before. In this scenario, we have known that in India, for every 400 people, there's an NGO. Mm-hmm. That's the ratio. In this context, what is the progress and the impact of this association in a developing country like India in the past few years? How much it has changed?
Yeah, well, I think one of India's many, many strengths is its civil society. And I think civil society has proven to be the backbone of India. And through what you just mentioned, I wasn't aware of that many NGOs, but I was aware of many, but not that many. I think it's a good proof for the vitality of NGOs in the country. And for us, particularly in a moment of crisis, say, for example, post-tsunami, a very close collaboration between the United Nations and NGOs in countries affected by the tsunami have proven invaluable. I mean, there's nothing more that I can say. Without civil society in member states in general, but in this case in particular in India, the UN wouldn't be where it is.
Let's move. Oh, so many hands. I feel bad that I. Okay, that's fine. So let's take the gentleman on the aisle.
Hello, sir. Welcome to FDU. Thank you for visiting our campus.
Thank you.
I'm Chris Caldiero, Assistant Professor of Communication Studies here, and I have a number of PR campaign students here, including Ashley, who asked a very good question. Earlier in your talk, you mentioned how the UN tries to work with member states in order to build goodwill for more sensitive situations in the future. And in public relations, that's really building a reservoir of goodwill to dip into later in order to get through crisis situations in the context of PR. But my question was, I was wondering if you could speak to the North Korean situation, and specifically in the context, if you would, of the fact that Secretary General Ban Ki-moon is South Korean. And again, in the larger context, how is it that UN employees like yourself, like the Secretary General, are able to, if at all, separate yourself out from loyalty to your home country, your home member state, and again, in the context of the Secretary General in the South Korea and North Korea situation? Thank you.
Thank you. Well, it's a question that I think each one of us is being faced with on a day-to-day basis. And Maria Luisa told me about an experience during the last Soccer World Cup where this kind of unity of United Nations kind of suddenly broke up into all the national teams that participated in the World Cup. I think the reality is we all have roots, we all come from somewhere, and I think we should not be ashamed of coming from somewhere. I think one has to know where one comes from. But what makes the UN so fascinating is that the goals it tries to pursue are in most cases universal goals. And I must tell you, after six, now nearly 8 months with the UN, I slowly lose the national approach. Sure, the reference point is still the 30 years in the Austrian Foreign Service and the years that I spent representing my own country. But I'm kind of slowly feeling that sort of drifting a little bit away, and it becomes easier and easier to identify myself with those more universal goals that the UN stands for. Now, that is sort of the more general part of your question. The more specific one on Korea, Earlier today, for some of you who may have followed that closer, the Secretary General came out with a very strong statement on North Korea. And I think any Secretary General at this stage, given what is happening and seems to be happening in North Korea, would have come out with that statement. But given the fact that the Secretary General is particularly knowledgeable and obviously has the experience having grown up in a subcontinent, if you will, that was destroyed by the Korean War, he feels very strongly for the people of the region and obviously would like to see rather a rapprochement between North and South than what we've been seeing for the last few days. And I think he was very hopeful when the now new president of South Korea, before even being inaugurated, kind of reached out and offered a hand of South Korea to the North. And unfortunately, that was being rejected by the developments that we all heard and read about.
We have barely enough time for one more question. I'd like to recognize Dr. Murphy, who started us off this evening. Use the microphone.
It may seem not fair for me to ask a question, but I really want to get this out before I have to leave the room. I serve as the main representative of the university at the United Nations and had the great pleasure of speaking on a panel with you about 2 weeks ago commemorating the International Day of Happiness. The UN has about 117 international days that it commemorates. And with the snap of a finger, that day is gone. And all of those days represent and commemorate something really of crucial importance to the United Nations. What is your department doing to make it more than just a fleeting day, but to keep the energy going and to keep the thinking going? And how do you engage non-governmental organizations like Fairleigh Dickinson University to continue the education of the general public on these crucial issues?
You have 60 seconds.
Before the executioner comes, as you mentioned earlier. What I can tell you from my colleagues is the moment an event ends, they already come up with ideas how they can do it the next year. So in that sense, within the United Nations, the thinking, the planning, the preparing, the identifying of appropriate or interesting speakers, participants, presenters, moderators, really continues 365 days a year. The manifestation of the Day of Happiness, hopefully, is also not just a one day occurrence, and you can feel it. You can feel it on more than just that one day. As you know, these days are being created on the basis of the initiative taken by member states, and all of these ideas. In this particular case, Bhutan, the Kingdom of Bhutan, the Himalayan Kingdom of Bhutan, was a driving force behind the National Day of Happiness, given that their gross national happiness indicator is sort of an indicator that's slowly but surely finding the way its way also into the writings and studies of economists around the world. I agree with you. It should not just be this one day manifestation. It should be translated around the year. And in a way, the work of the UN, and not just of my colleagues who prepared those days and the manifestations, I think does that. The question is, do we have the power, the energy, the resources, and also the public's attention to kind of keep it present every single day, given that there are so many other days to be celebrated? And the NGOs and academic institutions obviously can help us. And one of the reasoning behind the Academic Impact Program is that we request universities to take up priority themes of the United Nations and make them their priorities through programs, seminars, conferences, lectures, discussions, and so on. And that's why we are particularly grateful for the cooperation of academic institutions.
Thank you.
And NGOs.
Before we part, I'd like to take the opportunity to highlight a few of our upcoming programs. Tomorrow night at 7 o'clock in this very room, there will be a screening of a film called Girl Rising, which will look at the challenges facing girls in 9 different countries with respect to receiving an education. On the 4th, April 4th, we will be having our Global Enterprise Network breakfast on the Metropolitan campus. We'll be focusing on doing business in Korea. On April 16th, we will be broadcasting a video conference from UN headquarters to both of our campuses and to a network of affiliate schools. The topic there will be children and armed conflict around the world. And then, of course, we can't leave out April 17th, Earth Day, you knew that, when there will be Earth Day celebrations on both campuses, capped off by a visit by the permanent representative of Peru on the Metropolitan campus, and there will be transportation from Florham to Metro. Now, without further ado, please join me in thanking our guest for an excellent conversation.